Good evening. My name is Wallingford Lee. I'm the producer of a program by the name of the International Grapevine, a program that has been in the New York area for the last 15 years, give or take. This is a program that is viewed all the way in Queens, Brooklyn, Long Island, Westchester, and a good part, of course, of also Philadelphia. We've had the opportunity to work with very important guests that have been on our program that talk about a lot of important things. The International Grapevine is an innovative television program that I said has been around for a long time. The Grapevine has been in existence for more than 15 years. And, you know, one of the biggest pleasures that we had was the opportunity when we worked with the ex-president of Costa Rica, Luis Guillermo Solis. That program was a total beautiful program on a blast, of course.
Well, no question about it. Costa Rica is a very quiet country. And, you know, one of the things that a lot of people are surprised to know that they abolished the army back in 1948. And how can they live without an army and without any problem? What would be your response to someone like that every time they are surprised to find out that this nation, a small nation, that has kept their nose clean and they don't have an army, and they have abolished the army back in 1948?
Well, you know, this happened as it was a very transcendental decision that was made by Mr. José Figueres after winning our last civil war. He's the only general that has disbanded his victorious army in the history of the world. He decided that it was a good idea to put an end to the call of weapons and instead use the resources that are many required to keep an army and invest them in education, in health, in housing, in, you know, projects that would bring development to the country. So I think that this was the secret, not only to put an end to the army as a permanent institution, which of course in and of itself brought stability. We know in the Latin American and Caribbean experience what armies do to countries, but also allowed the resources that were going to be spent in the army to be invested otherwise in more human development projects. And I think that was a very good idea. Now, we didn't have a strong army to begin with before the army was abolished, this is to be said. But this whole notion of turning our security to the hands of a civilian police, a police force that's under civilian authority, and our international defense on international tribunals and multilateral international tribunals was not only unprecedented in the world, but it has become a brand of Costa Rica in throughout the world.
Our program continued to focus on the lives of people that live in the New York Tri-State area. And as I mentioned, New York Tri-State area, we cover a great big part of the program. And when we talk about why the Grapevine has been so successful, is one of the reasons that we have been able to know who to bring in our program. Bring a lot of people who are qualified to talk about so many different important things that are important to our community and to the places that we work. Recently, we did a tremendous program talking about the impact of China penetrating Panama and the work and the things that they have done in the Panama Canal. So that was one of the most great program that we have done recently. It was done almost a month ago. So sit back and take a few minutes and watch the impact of this program that we did, the penetration of China in Panama today. Mr. Lewis Marshall, welcome to our program. It's been a long time, and we're looking forward to work with you as a Panamanian American, that you know everything that goes on out there. And we feel very pleased to have you as a special guest in this program today.
Thank you for inviting me.
Well, let's start a little bit from the beginning. It's very clear that Panama owns the canal and control all of the canal. When was the canal passed over to Panama by the American government?
Okay, this all began October the 1st, 1979, whereas the canal zone, which is the territory, ceased to exist under the United States. And the actual turning over of the canal, that agreement was signed at the same time. However, it will not go into effect until December the 31st, 1999. Both treaties were signed on September the 7th, 1977. That's when they actually signed it. But it did not go into effect as far as the canal until December the 31st, 1999.
Our program is known for inflation approach to most of our clients with various issues that are extremely important. These topics touch a lot of hearts in Queens and Brooklyn, of course. But more importantly, the importance of our program, the direct contact and social feeling that we have with a good portion of our client base. And as I mentioned before, the demographic of our program is from 40-year-old folks to 65 years old, and primarily made of male and female audience. And it's very well received, as I mentioned to you. Now on the next program you're gonna have the opportunity to see a program that we did recently. The name of this program is The Endurance Inspiration Who Made a Difference. We're gonna have the opportunity on this program to talk about the great Harry Belafonte, who was born in Harlem, New York, but raised in Jamaica, in the West Indies, and came back to New York as a great singer and also over a period of time as an actor. And part of the program, we had the great opportunity to work with the wonderful one, Sidney Poitier. I think in 1967, if my memory is right, Sidney Poitier was the hottest actor. He did about three great programs. Guess Who's Coming to Dinner? A tremendous movie. And of course, In the Heat of the Night and The Middle of the Fields. Both of these guys made a big difference to the community. Sidney never took a part in a movie where black people look weak or begging. He always represented himself like he ought to be. Sit back and have an opportunity to look at these two great guys that they were in the great band.
Well, I want to, the audience, you have a flavor when we talk about them. I want you to describe a little bit just exactly who is Harry Belafonte and a little bit about his background.
You gave us a good start in terms of the broad outlines. Belafonte and Poitier share a birth year in 1927. Both of them have Caribbean backgrounds, although a good bit of their formative years are spent in Harlem. Belafonte gets into performing relatively early, as does Poitier. And, you know, they actually come up through relatively similar systems in terms of the intersections of where black artists can go at that point, which means institutions and performance spaces, at least in the beginning, primarily rooted in the black community, because that's the outlet you have at the time. One of the things that I think makes them One of the things that I think is very key to both of them is that they very quickly break out of that mold and achieve much wider fame. I mean, in the current way we would probably describe it currently, at least in terms of music, is you would say they are, you know, quote unquote, crossover artists.
As you can see, based on the few minutes that we have talked a little bit about the International Grapevine and the purpose of the Grapevine, we continue to serve our community by supplying our community with high-grade programs and sophisticated guests who brings a great deal of knowledge and sophistication to our world, and of course, great satisfaction to our program. Part of the ability of doing something of this magnitude, we're trying to penetrate Central America. Central America is one of the tourist attractions that Americans love, and a great deal of Americans live in Costa Rica. And after doing a program with the president of Costa Rica, we decided that we want to penetrate that. So we're doing this type of program to bring it to the attention of our beautiful public in Costa Rica. And as we move forward, I want to take this opportunity to present to our audience a very interesting part of the program as we close out. We want to have you take a close attention to this part of the program. We're taking a close look
of the 2024 political race as it begins to take speed going forward. So us as Americans, all of us are sitting, watching who's going to be the president, who's going to win. And all I would like to suggest to each one of you, if you can and you should and you must, take the opportunity to vote for the person that you think is more qualified to run this nation. And again, thank you for watching our programs. We hope it has been to your liking. And this is Wallingford Lee, of course, saying good night. And we hope to see you like we see you every other week watching our program. Thank you. Welcome to our program, Jaime.
Thank you so much for inviting me. You know, I love being with you guys. I'm here anytime you need me. I enjoy doing this show a lot.
Well, we've been doing it for a while, and I know you've been very busy, so it was good to get you. Well, let's talk a little bit about the politics. I'm not good at politics, but, you know, I know a few things. And tell me, how important is the political race to the White House now? How important is it?
Well, the presidential election next year is going to be an existential election for the United States, like never before. We can talk about the presidential election of Lincoln, the second term of Roosevelt. You know, we can talk about some historical presidencies, but I don't think that the one that is coming now is less than those historical ones. I think that the impact that this presidential election is going to have in the United States is going to make that election the most important election in history.